which means there are probably devils that will try to make us crazy by attacking our minds. And with that thought in mind, I've found certain words in the Bible that perfectly describe some of the ways that the enemy attacks us. Thus far in this series, we've looked at the grinders, Ecclesiastes 12:3. Beware of the grinders, because as their name implies, they will try to wear you out and run you down and literally grind you right into the ground. Jesus tried to warn Peter that the devil was looking to sift him as wheat, literally to put him through the meat grinder. We then looked at the emptiers, Nahum chapter 2. Those emptier demons will try and rob you in whatever way they can. They'll try to rob you of your time, rob you of your joy. They'll try to rob you of eternal rewards and leave you empty. Thirdly, we looked at the tormentors. Matthew 18:34 declares, "And his Lord was wroth and delivered him to the tormentors till he should pay all that he was due unto him." Are there actually demons with that name? No. But their actions speak of what we're up against. This morning I talked about Robin Williams, and there's no doubt in my mind that he was a tortured soul, tormented by the forces of darkness that drove him to take his own life. The devil will try and torment us, hoping that we'll quit on God and go back to our old sinful ways, and that's where we left off in this series. And tonight I want to look at the next enemy, Lamentations chapter 1, if you have your Bible. Lamentations chapter 1, right after the book of Jeremiah. Tonight we're going to look at the pursuers. Beware of the pursuers. Lamentation 1:6. "And from the daughter of Zion all her beauty is departed. Her princes are become like harts that find no pasture, and they are gone without strength before the pursuer." Chapter 4, verse 18. "They hunt our steps, that we cannot go into our streets. Our end is near, our days are fulfilled, for the end is come. Our persecutors are swifter than the eagles of the heaven. They pursued us upon the mountains. They laid wait for us in the wilderness." Notice what we are told in verse 18. They hunt our steps, just as a predator pursues its prey. I like those National Geographic specials on wild animals, especially the ones about lions and tigers. And what amazes me is how much those lions devote to stalking their prey. Because it's hot, they got to pick their battles, because they don't have a whole lot of energy in that hot sun. They never attack immediately. They'll just lay back and casually watch a herd of zebras, gazelles, whatever it may be. And they appear to be casual, lazily watching this herd like they're not interested. That's the appearance they want to give. But the truth is, they are intensely watching those zebras, looking for any old zebras that are weak, that may be feeble, for any young ones that don't offer much fight, or perhaps some careless zebra that wanders off from the main herd thinking that the grass is greener someplace else. Those lions will sometimes pursue that herd for 2 or 3 days, maybe longer. Many times they're so far back in the bush that the zebras are unaware that they're even there, or they just forget that they're there. And that's how those lions want it. They're hoping to catch their prey off guard with a surprise attack, and then they move in swiftly for the kill. And with that thought in mind, I find it interesting that the Bible compares the devil to a roaring lion that's stalking us, hoping to devour us. 1 Peter 5:8, "Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour." Earlier I mentioned Jesus warning Peter at the Last Supper. The indication is that the devil had been pursuing Peter for quite a while, just stalking him, pursuing him like a lion, waiting for the right opportunity to strike. And even though Jesus tried to warn him, Peter never saw the enemy's attack coming. It was that swift. And but for the grace of God, Peter could have ended up just like Judas on the end of a rope. In the book of Job, God asked Satan if he had considered his servant Job. Considered him. The devil basically told God not only had he considered him, but he was chomping at the bit to get at him. Now, the one thing we as Christians got going for us is the fact that God is in control, and that old lion can't touch us without God's permission. So that's good to know. That's a wonderful thing we need to know and be aware of. Where the trouble starts is when Christians let their spiritual guard down and become comfortable in the Christian life and casual when it comes to sin. Every so often you'll hear a story about a zookeeper being mauled by a lion or a tiger. And it happens because that zookeeper becomes so familiar with that lion, is around those lions every day, and stops seeing them as being dangerous. And the moment he gets too close to that cage or stops being cautious in his actions, that lion will pounce on him so fast. That's what happens. The same thing will happen to us when we stop being sober and vigilant, when we stop resisting the devil, when we allow ourselves to be comfortable when it comes to sin, casual when it comes to sin. Samson is a perfect example of this. The Philistines symbolize the enemy, the forces of darkness, and the enemy was pursuing him each step of the way. But he had the touch of God on his life, and the enemy couldn't defeat him. Samson got soft spiritually. He was running with the wrong crowd, hanging out in places he shouldn't be, got involved with an ungodly woman, and all those things caused him to become casual towards the enemy. Three different times the Philistines were literally in his closet and came upon him, and he was able to defeat him the first two times. You would have thought something would have clicked where he might have said, you know what, I've got to be on guard. These jokers are in my house now. They're not meeting me on the battlefield anymore. They're actually in my house. It should have been his wake-up call that he was being pursued by the enemy. But Samson was so out of touch with God that he didn't even realize the Holy Spirit had departed from him. Another way in which the enemy pursues us is when Christians don't use their spiritual discernment that God has given us. Discernment is like our spiritual radar that warns us of danger and trouble, that tips us off that things aren't exactly right. And if we're not using discernment, we are literally flying blind when it comes to the enemy. I saw this video of a guy who was swimming where there was a no swimming sign. He was out there swimming without a care in the world. And then all of a sudden you see this crocodile heading his way. The people on the bridge above him finally got his attention by screaming at him, pointing. And this guy starts swimming back to shore for all he was worth. But that crocodile kept pursuing him. And the only thing that saved this guy was, number one, they threw something in the water to distract the crocodile. Evidently, people would throw food to this crocodile from the bridge, so when he heard the water splash, he stopped for a moment to see if it was something worth eating. And secondly, the crocodile appeared to have already been eaten, so he wasn't pursuing very hard. He was just pursuing at a slow rate. Those crocodiles can go a lot faster. But the whole thing could have been avoided if this guy had used some discernment. So also Christians that aren't listening to God, that aren't hearing the voice of God. God talks to me all the time. And I try to quiet myself, be still and know God so that I can hear the voice of God, what he's telling me. And yet there's folks that can go a whole lifetime. I don't know what you're talking about. I never hear God. So be it. And let me just add this. You'll only have spiritual discernment when you walk in the Spirit. So maybe that's what it is. They're not hearing from God because they're not walking in the Spirit. Their flesh is controlling them to such a degree that they're not hearing God. It's only then that you'll be sensitive to the Holy Spirit's leading. And I think one reason why Christians make so many bad decisions is that they have no spiritual discernment. I mean, put another way, if folks were listening to God, they would be here tonight. Because there ain't no way you're going to sit down and watch some garbage on TV and not have God nudge and say, you need to be supporting this church. You need to be in church. Amen. You don't need that lousy TV. You need some preaching. So, they're not hearing the voice of God because that's what God would be telling them. And like that swimmer, they're in dangerous waters, being pursued by the enemy, and they don't even know it. So another nature show about wolves. Wolves are predator, but they're not nearly the lethal killing machines that lions and tigers are. They don't have the claws that lions have. They don't have the bite that lions have. So in this documentary, this pack of wolves were pursuing it. It was either an elk or a moose. And obviously, they couldn't take it on head on. This thing was big. They couldn't attack it head on, but they were starving. So they couldn't bring it down with a direct attack. So the way they pursued it is a term called they worried their prey. That's what it's called. They worried their prey. And what that term means is they would take turns chasing it to wear it down. One wolf would chase it for a while. This thing would be running. And then he would drop out. Then another wolf would take over to wear it down or worry it. And all the while they were nipping and slashing at its legs to weaken it. And they would continue pursuing their prey until it got too tired or too weak to resist them. And that's when they would go in for the kill. Our enemy will also try to worry us to death. Rather than come at us like a roaring lion, he will instead just try to nip at our heels and try to wear us down spiritually. Just little agitations. Not enough to put you over the edge, but just stuff that keeps constantly messing with you. There will be times when we aren't able to read our Bible, when we're not able to walk in the Spirit, when we're not strong in the Lord. And on top of all that, sometimes we're flat running out empty. We're just running on empty. Exhausted and worn out. And those are the times that we're vulnerable. When he sees that we're vulnerable, and he will try to just nip at us just enough to discourage us. Note, we are very vulnerable at those times, and the enemy will try to wear us down by continually pursuing us. What should we do when we find ourselves in those situations? Stop running. Stop running and simply call on God. He will fight our battles, and he will take care of the enemy. He will also strengthen us in whatever battle we find ourselves in. So we got to realize, he doesn't expect us to fight this battle in our own strength. We got to turn to God. In the flesh, I can get discouraged, but when I'm walking in the Spirit, it doesn't matter if anyone's here. When I'm in the Spirit, I'm doing it unto the Lord. And that's how we got to get through it. When you're at work, if you try to deal with all the office politics and the harassment and the co-workers in your flesh, you're going to be fighting somebody by the end of the day, or want to fight somebody, because it just nips at you. But when you're in the Spirit, it's the only way you can handle that kind of stress from our jobs. We have been given authority in the name of Jesus, and instead of being continually pursued by the enemy, instead of always being on the defensive, in the name of Jesus, we as soldiers in the Lord's army can go on the attack and pursue the enemy and take the fight to him. That's what we can do. Again, turning back to Lamentations 4:18, we are told that the enemy is hunting down our steps, pursuing us so that we cannot go out into the streets. You see that there? And the enemy has us scared into thinking that the end is near and that there's no hope and no chance of winning this war that we're in. That's what I see right there. They hunt our steps, that we cannot go in our streets. Our end is near, our days are fulfilled. The end has come. It's all over, folks. But the devil is a liar and the father of lies. Because in 2 Timothy 1:7, we are told, "For God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of love and of power and of a sound mind." Hallelujah. We don't have to have a spirit of fear. Don't be afraid. God is in control. Don't let it mess with your mind. Don't get an unsound mind. God is in control. Don't go forth in weakness and defeat. He has given us a spirit of power. Hallelujah. It's time to stop being hunted. Stop being the victim. Stop making excuses. Stop living defeated lives. Stop being powerless Christians. It's time to be more than conquerors through him that loved us. Amen?
Amen.
It's also time that we took back our streets. Bruce has been going out knocking on doors. He's taken back the streets. Verse 18 states that the people could not go out in the streets. There's neighborhoods that are unsafe. Churches have moved in there, bought real estate that they were practically given away because the neighborhoods were so bad. Pacific Garden Missions comes to mind. They bought real estate that nobody else wanted because it was like the Bowery, the derelict district. And they started winning souls to Jesus. And guess what? That property is some of the most valued real estate. They've had offers on it. They said, "We're not selling." They cleaned up the neighborhood. All those drunks and drug addicts that were just laying around in the alleyways, they got them cleaned up and now they're working for the church. They took back the street. And the same thing is happening in Camden
And some of these other places, churches are tired of living in fear. So they're just going out there and taking it to the enemy and winning souls to Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Las Vegas the same way. Las Vegas has a high rate of prostitution and runaways. People go there and they lose everything. And there's churches there that are now reaching out and have ministries for, especially for these people that are given to immorality. Out in the Ocean City, there's a rescue mission out there. There's people that go out there and lose their shirts, lose their cars, and they're living under the boardwalk because they don't have any money to get back home if they have a home. So there's a rescue mission for families that have lost everything from gambling. They're taking back those streets. We got to look at it like this. This world is God's property. And so are those people that are in bondage to sin. And God wants us to take back those streets and recover all those lost souls that are in bondage to sin. And instead of being pursued by the enemy, it's time we do some pursuing and get the enemy on the defensive. Hallelujah.
Dear God.